Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Libraries Facilities Financing Authority Board meeting. And then back to back, we'll be running the Library Joint Powers Authority Board meeting at about 6:15. As an attendee, your microphone is muted for the entire presentation. We are not taking open mic comments. You do not need a microphone, camera, or a screen if you only want to listen to the meeting, as this meeting is accessible by landline or mobile phone. If you need assistance, please call the library's telephone information line at 1-831-427-7713. To join this webinar using a telephone only, please dial any of the following numbers. I'll read two of them off to you. 1-888-788-0099 or 1-833-548-0282. And then slowly enter the webinar ID of 974-3018-0268. The board will take public comments as outlined in the posted agenda and in the next slides. All comments must include the agenda item number and be received prior to the close of public comment on that agenda item. If you're joining by computer, you may use the Q&A feature to type in your comments. On the attendee control bar, you'll see the Q&A icon. You'll see audio settings to the left, the Q&A icon, and then leave meeting in red letters. If you're using a mobile device, the Q&A icon may appear near the top of the screen. You'll see leave meeting in the upper left corner, and then the Q&A icon over to the right. Alternatively, you may call the library's telephone information line to timely submit your comments. Again, that number is 831-427-7713, and these will be read by the moderator. Once the board meeting begins, if you're joining by computer to see all of the panelists, you may need to use the Zoom control bar and select gallery view. Depending on the size of your mobile device screen, you may need to scroll over to view whomever's speaking. If you're accessing this meeting via the web browser only, you may not see all of the panelists at one time, only the panelists speaking. The chair of the board, Jamie Goldstein, will now call the meeting to order. We will transition to gallery view. Please stand by. Chair Goldstein, over to you.
Great. Thank you, Moderator Jones. Can we have a roll call, please?
Director Tina Friend.
Here.
Director Carlos Palacios.
Here.
Vice Chair Martin Bernal.
Here.
Chair Jamie Goldstein.
Here. Is there any additional material for tonight's meeting?
There is not.
Okay. Any changes to tonight's agenda?
There's not.
Okay. So this is a meeting for the Santa Cruz Libraries Facilities Financing Authority. We will now take public comment on any item that is not on today's agenda for the Library Facilities Financing Authority, but it was within this board's jurisdiction. Do we have any public comment?
Chair Goldstein, we do not have any public comment at this time.
Okay, so that takes us to the next item on our agenda, which is the Executive Director Report. Director Nimitz, do you have a report for us today?
I included a brief written report about the status of our projects. We have made significant progress over the last month on most of our projects. Aptos, we're completing the evaluation for design build. It's been a really interesting process. Capitola, I submitted some photographs. Keeps going along. We're pretty excited about it. Downtown branch had a presentation by Group 4 for the subcommittee of the City Council on Tuesday night. We had a lot of people attend the presentation and give comments. It was looking at the financial feasibility of the downtown library in a multi-use facility. La Selva Beach continues to progress. Again, I submitted some photos of La Selva Beach, and Scotts Valley's just signing contracts. So we'll be getting a new roof, new HVAC, new improvements to the parking lot, and some seismic improvements. We're very excited.
All right. Thank you, Susan. So that takes us to the consent calendar. There's one item on today's consent calendar, which is consideration of the May 7th LFFA board meeting minutes. Does anyone want to pull any item from consent? Seeing none, does anyone from the public want to pull an item from consent?
There are none.
Okay. So with that, I'm looking for a motion on consent.
I'll move approval of the minutes of May 7th, 2020.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Can we get a roll call vote, please?
Director Friend?
Aye.
Director Palacios?
Yes.
Vice Chair Martin Bernal?
Aye.
Chair Jamie Goldstein?
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. So that takes us to general business, and we have no general business this evening for the LFFA. So that takes us to our schedule for upcoming meetings, which is currently scheduled for, next meeting is scheduled for August 6th, 9 a.m. at the downtown branch. And with that, I will adjourn the LFFA meeting and then reconvene us as the Santa Cruz City County Library Joint Powers Board. So can we, I'll call the meeting to order. Why don't we get another roll call just in case somebody is just joining us now?
Director Tina Friend?
Here.
Director Carlos Palacios?
Here.
Vice Chair Martin Bernal?
Here.
Chair Jamie Goldstein?
Here. Are there any additional materials on tonight's, we've received for tonight's agenda?
There are none.
Okay. Are there any changes you'd like to make to the agenda this evening?
No.
Okay. So that brings us to the report out from closed session. This evening, the board met in closed session prior to this meeting. We reviewed the items listed on the agenda, which was just labor negotiations. The board gave direction to our labor negotiators and took no reportable action. In addition, on May 7th, the board also met on closed session. Again, it was on labor negotiations. The board met with the board's labor negotiators, gave direction, but took no reportable action. So with that, we'll turn to oral communication. Oral communication is the opportunity for anybody, member of the public, to address this board in anything that's not on tonight's agenda, but is within this board's jurisdiction. Moderator Jones, do we have any oral communications this evening?
Not at this time, Chair Goldstein.
Okay. With that, I will close public comment, and we'll take us to item five, which is report by library director. Director Nimitz, do you have anything you want to add to the written report?
I just wanted Eric Howard, who was our assistant director, to do an update on our evolution towards opening.
Thank you, Susan, and thank you, board members. We are moving forward to bring back some normalcy to the services that everyone is familiar with, which is physical materials returning into our patrons' hands. And we have had now for a couple weeks the downtown library, Scotts Valley, and Aptos providing curbside. Initially, it was to bring the items back to that patrons have been waiting on since March when we closed, and that was approximately 1,300 patrons. And we've moved through that, and now we are happy to announce that we are taking new requests for items, and beginning next week at Felton and Live Oak, we'll have curbside there as well. And so this means that you can go online or call, which we never stopped doing. We're always responding to our patrons, even when our physical buildings close. But now you can call and request a new item to be picked up at one of those five locations. And we're continuing to expand those services that we offer. And I really have to commend staff who have done a lot to make that work. We are also just being very careful around both, obviously, the physical distancing, both for our patrons and for the staff. Additionally, when we receive the items back, we quarantine them for 72 hours. And even though the guidance that we get is that the virus is people are most at risk when you're breathing and you're less than 6 feet apart. Because the science shows us that the virus can last on some surfaces for up to 72 hours, we're taking that extra step to ensure the safety of our materials. And then additionally, I wanted to just say too that we were able to receive a state grant so that For children receiving school lunch over the summer, we are going to be providing services for them, and that's approximately 600 students at 9 different locations. We'll meet with them 3 times over the course of the summer to provide them with books and then also STEAM kits as well. And our virtual programming continues to expand. Supervisor Coonerty ran a book discussion for us. We've done a number of virtual programs that have been very successful at helping parents manage the stress of the current crisis, work with their children more, and also, this has also included a successful program where we had a diverse range of religious leaders talk about what this is meaning to them. And it's been a powerful tool. And I also want to applaud our staff for pivoting quickly during this time and responding to those needs.
I just want to add, we've started our first virtual summer reading program. This is new for us, and we had to do a lot of changes to the program. We had a program last Saturday, which was about bats. We've been working with our vendors, and it was a great program. We had 122 different groups logging in, and people loved it. So we're on track to head into our summer reading program. We also have a program for adults if you're interested. Very exciting.
Well, thank you.
Oh, I have to say one more because I love this. We're figuring out how to do our Read to Dogs program digitally. And so that should be up and running within the next week. I'm pretty excited about that too.
Do the dogs have to participate by Zoom?
They do. They do. Actually, Sarah probably knows a lot about it, but yeah.
All right. Well, thank you for the update. Sounds like a lot of fun things. That takes us to the next item on the agenda, which is a report by Friends of the Santa Cruz Public Libraries. Do we have an oral report? Do we have a member of the-
We have the wonderful Bob White joining us.
Oh, actually it's-
LAC.
Yeah, oh. Marsha Greenspan is here.
Oh, I'm sorry, Marsha.
Okay,
I did this last time too.
It's
sorry.
Okay.
I get so excited to hear from Bob. Sorry, Marsha.
No problem. Well, I am heading into my third month in the role of ED, and I just have to say, getting to observe and collaborate the staff at the library, working through these exceptional challenges has been incredible. I'm just so impressed, and I feel really honored to be supporting their work. So the Friends of the Libraries remain committed to providing more and more opportunity for the community at large to support the library system. We have already begun to expand our presence online. I've been coordinating with the library's marketing team and with Susan Nemitz to bring some meaningful fundraising and engagement opportunities forward. So we have a current mail list of about 8,000 friend supporters, and it's a great place to start. We plan to see that number grow in the coming months. We've just added a new part-time community engagement staff to our team. We'll be onboarding him this coming week. And the plan is he will help us to grow our audience and to create more relevant opportunities for community engagement and fundraising. This week, we brought the Downtown Library's subcommittee's public survey to our mail list, and it was exciting. Through analytics, we saw that more than 300 Friends supporters engaged with the survey through the email we sent. We also promoted the library subcommittee's public forum, and we were able to track that 30 Friends supporters accessed that meeting through the email we sent out. So we have a really engaged and supportive audience. And so we continue to expand our fundraising and advocacy work on behalf of the libraries. And I'm just sincerely looking forward to sharing some new initiatives in the coming months.
All right.
Yep.
Thank you for that presentation.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Be fun to meet you in person when we can do that. Okay, so that takes us then to the report by Libraries Advisory Commission. Do we have Bob White here this evening?
We do. Hang on just a moment, please.
This is the incredible Bob White.
Commissioner White, your mic is on.
Oh, thank you very much. Good evening, and I'm Bob White, Chair of the Library Advisory Commission, and I have a brief report to make this evening. So the Library Advisory Commission met on Monday, May 18th via Zoom teleconference. And at that meeting, the commission discussed and reviewed several items. And I'll just briefly go over those. And the first item discussed was the fiscal year 2020-2021 work plan proposal and opening plan. And the commission will be working closely with Library Director Susan Nimitz to monitor and provide feedback regarding the phases of the opening plan as we gradually reopen the Santa Cruz Public Libraries. And I just like to make an observation. I think the plan has been well thought out, and I know a lot of work went into this. The second item that we discussed was the fiscal year 2020 and 2021 budgets. And at a future meeting, the Library Advisory Commission will be reviewing with Library Director Susan Nimitz more conservative revenue estimates, budget assumptions, and expenditures. So that will be happening in the future, near future. And that basically concludes my report this evening. Are there any questions?
Are there any questions for Chairman White? All right, seeing none, thank you, Bob, for the presentation. Thank you for all the work at the LAC.
Thank you very much.
That takes us to comments by board members. Do we have any comments by board members this evening? All right. So next item on the agenda then is the consent calendar. The consent calendar are administrative items that are generally taken in one vote. I see we have two items on the consent calendar this evening. Does any board member want to pull any item from consent? Seeing none, Moderator Jones, do we have anyone from the public who'd like to pull an item off consent?
Not at this time, Chair Goldstein.
Okay, so with that, look for a motion for consent.
I'll move the consent agenda for approval.
A second.
Okay, can we get a roll call, please?
Director Tina Friend?
Aye.
Director Palacios?
Yes.
Vice Chair Martin Bernal?
Yes.
Chair Jamie Goldstein.
Yes. Motion passes unanimously. And that takes us to the general business on tonight's agenda. And the first item of business this evening is the fiscal year 2021 Santa Cruz Public Library budget. Director Nimitz, can we get a staff report, please?
This is very much like what you saw last month, but with greater detail. I want to say it is a preliminary budget, and because of the ambiguity of the current economic conditions, we believe that we're going to have to come back probably several times over the next fiscal year and work with you in more detail on the budget. We need to spend more time with staff and our community, like the Library Advisory Commission, to really drill down on some of these cuts. And so I expect even in August that we will be bringing some changes to you. With all that, we're asking you to approve the reduction of our budget by $3.8 million as a starting place. If you look on page 45, we are suggesting a hiring freeze. We currently have 8 positions that are vacant right now. Those aren't full-time equivalent positions, but we believe we can save $500,000 a year that way. We are suggesting that we not utilize our temporary pool for the entire fiscal year. That actually has an impact on 62 individuals. It equals 26 FTE. Had to calculate that. That's incredibly painful. And save $776,000. We're suggesting that we reduce our salaries budget by 10%, consistent with the City of Santa Cruz. You'll see in a later motion, we had suggested a furlough, but we can have conversations about that. I think the important point at this point, though, is to approve the target of $700,000 from the personnel budget. And we're suggesting $300,000 in savings from an early retirement program. And that is also an agenda item. We believe this will result in significant reductions to service hours. We'll also talk about that later. We are recommending only a small reduction in our book budget of about $80,000. We calculated if we kept the book budget at 8%, and the reduction was over $300,000, and our book budget's pretty tight to begin with. We're also going to be in the process of opening two libraries in the next fiscal year. And so we think that $80,000 is probably the most we can take, and we believe we're going to have to supplement that with gifts and grants as well. We're also suggesting cutting our non-personnel budget by $150,000. We haven't fully decided exactly how those cuts will be applied. It's something we really need to work with staff and the community on. And then we're suggesting that we utilize our unrestricted fund balance by $1.6 million. With that, what I'm asking of you is to approve the $3.8 million in spending reductions and direct staff to monitor the impacts associated with COVID-19 shelter-in-place order on the libraries and provide financial updates at each Library Joint Powers Board meeting.
All right. Thank you, Susan. Do we have any questions from board members?
Just had a clarification. So Susan, as I understand from the report, the portion of the budget savings from salaries or compensation that would be consistent with the city of Santa Cruz is $1 million, right? Total?
It's $700,000, but I do believe that how this is applied makes a difference between if we do furloughs or other options, how that works with a early retirement program. So they're slightly intertwined, and the 10% recommendation though is $700,000.
I see. So the million incorporates the early retirement.
Early retirement.
Got it. Okay, that's a distinction. Okay, thank you.
I have a question, Chair Goldstein. So Susan, just want to confirm that when we discussed, I have a visitor here.
A cute one though.
Yeah. When we discussed this at our last board meeting, that these are materially the same line items that we were looking at then. Okay.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Are there other questions?
I had a question about the $150,000 in other cuts. Could you give us some examples of the kind of things that we will be considering?
It's things like memberships. It's things like professional development. We just really have to, it's technology, and it's really difficult in this environment to be cutting technology. It's those kinds of things that we hope to take the $150,000 out of. And to be honest, this is a way so that we can have more in the collection. The collection's $150,000 above 8%.
Carlos, that answers your question. Are there any other questions? Okay, there's a couple things I wanted to ask about. I think starting at the top, and my most, I think the biggest question I have is I see that our actual ending fund balance at the end of 2019 was the 1.35 million. And then we're projecting a $917,000 deficit this year. But somehow the fund balance grew to 2.2 million in the budget overview. Is that something that, am I doing my math wrong, or is there any explanation, or is that something you can help me with, Susan?
I think you're accurate to point that out. I talked to Kira about it, and the 1.353 million was taken from the monthly dashboard report, but I think it really needs to become taken from the year end report. We did have a conversation today, and unfortunately the finance department of the city is moving today. So they're struggling, but I will get that clarified for you.
Okay, thank you.
It's a big difference, though. I must point that out. So,
yeah, it is a very big difference. The difference between starting the year at 2.2 and starting the year at about $450,000 would be a significant change. And I'm hopeful that the 1.35 is just a carryover from something that doesn't actually represent the fund accounting fund balance.
I know we did have a question about the 2.2. earlier this year, and I don't know if Kira wants to add, but we did ask the finance department to recheck that number, and they did and came back and said that was correct. Is that correct, Kira? Is Kira on? I don't see her. Oh, there she is. Sarah, could you unmute Kira?
Yes,
Kira, your mic is on.
Yeah, that's correct.
So they did double check the 2.2, but I think the question is valid.
Okay, well, thank you for looking into it. The 2.2 is really, frankly, the operational number, and if you are confident that number is correct, that's really what we're going off of, and a prior year's fund balance is of less importance. But obviously, we want these to be right, and so I would appreciate you looking into that. The next question I had is in the non-personnel operating expenditures. You talked about $150,000 savings in them. Is that a further reduction from what we see here? The total number was the 4.838 million.
It was included in that, but Kira, can you say where we took the 1.5 million or 150,000? What line item?
Yes, we took 95,000 from the downtown patrol officer. We took 25,000 from the training budget, and we took 30,000 from the midday bathroom cleanings for downtown and Brand Supporty.
Okay, but you're suggesting that those could be redistributed? Okay, because I did notice a number of items that I was going to ask about, but I think at this time it's probably not relevant. If you're going to be doing some more work on that particular area of the budget.
And yeah, correct. They can be redistributed. The savings can be redistributed.
Okay. And then I have one other question, and I'm really sorry if I'm just not understanding. So the recommendation is to approve a budget with $3.8 million in spending reductions and strategic use of the reserve. So the spending reductions total the 2.3 approximately, and the use of the reserves gets us to the closing the entire gap. That's the language.
Correct.
Okay, sorry,
I apologize.
That's fine. I think I was just not reading it. It wasn't $3.8 million of reductions. It's 2.3 million in reductions plus reserves. Okay. Thank you. Thank you guys for bearing with me with all those questions. If there aren't any other questions, I would go to the public. Moderator Jones, do we have any public comment?
Eric Goldstein, there are no public comments at this time.
Okay, we'll bring it back to the board for discussion. Who would like to go first?
I'll comment. I think this is a very difficult budget. It reflects the situation that we are all in local jurisdictions and both the city and county. And I know that we're adopting a budget that's gonna be very painful for staff, and I appreciate your work on it, and I appreciate the diligence you put into the recommendation, but I recognize also that's going to be very, very hard. And hopefully we will in the future get federal aid to backfill some of our revenues that may be of assistance to the city and the county. But I know at this point we can't count on any of that. So I would move approval of the recommended budget, A, items 1 and 2.
Okay. Is there a second on the motion?
I'll second that motion. And I also want to just add my comment that, you know, we just have such huge uncertainty and all of our agencies are dealing with this. So we know that we'll be continually looking at our sales tax numbers, especially as they comprise 53% of the budget, looking at that, looking at other revenues. So it is painful, but it is also prudent. And we have a responsibility to make sure that we're delivering a balanced budget. And I think this was a smart, strategic way to balance a lot of interest, to still think about the community first and delivering services across the system. So I also want to thank staff for having these difficult conversations. And I want to thank all the staff of the library overall for really bearing under very tough circumstances to continue with the mission of Santa Cruz Public Libraries. So I know we'll be talking much more in the coming months.
All right. Director Bernal, do you have any comments?
Yes. I just want to, I also echo those comments and also want to thank Susan and all the library staff who put their heads together to try to come up with ways to try to get through this crisis with a way to try to keep essential services, library services going. It's particularly difficult because we've got so many things going on with new branches is opening and so it's just a lot of things going on at once. So it's a lot of work, a lot of uncertainty. And I can appreciate that people are being patient and the ability to be flexible to be able to come up with something that will get us through this difficult period of time. And recognize that it's not easy for all of us in public service to be, you know, here to be able to have to sort of reduce services at this time when they're really needed and when it affects so many people. So thank you.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for those comments. I think I want to really reiterate the comments. I understand how challenging this has been for the entire library team, for everybody who's tuning in. It's been an incredibly trying time. I really appreciate the innovative ideas that are that the library is exploring to help expand services and everyone's willingness to pitch in and try something new. I think that's really inspiring for me. And I'm looking forward to seeing how that continues as we move forward, understanding that it's going to be hard. It's going to be a really trying time. I do want to propose a minor tweak to the motion. Just when I look at the non-personnel operating expenditures, you know, I know that in most of the costs are relatively fixed. Obviously, we can't really affect our PG&E bill or our insurance premiums. But I think that, I guess I would like to try to challenge to see if we could try to get to a larger number than the 150. I think that those are, you know, I understand they may not be sustainable in the long term, but I think this next year is really just kind of about going down to ground and doing everything we can to cut costs and preserve what we can and then move forward as an entity. So I don't know if that would be an amenable amendment to the motion maker, but to try to get that non-operating personnel budget down below the 150 target and further.
Be happy to try.
Okay. The other point I was going to make, and it is eluding me at the moment. So with that, I think we have a motion and a second on the floor. Is there any other, I guess the other point I want to make and just make it very clear to everybody that this budget as proposed by Director Nimitz and this board is set to vote on includes all of the reductions that Director Nimitz outlined. So to get us to a place where we're only proposing to use $1.6 million of reserves, which is a very significant hit on this board's available funding to cushion the blows of any future impact. It does include a lot of very challenging cuts. And so those are included in this motion. I just want everyone to be very aware of that. Okay, so with that, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, can we have a roll call, please?
Director Friend?
Aye.
Director Palacios?
Yes.
Vice Chair Bernal?
Yes.
Chair Goldstein?
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Okay, so that takes us to the next item on tonight's agenda, which is public service hour strategy. Director Nimes, do we have a staff report, please?
Yes, I do. Clearly, this level of funding cuts is going to have a remarkable effect on our public services. And I just wanted to talk through some of the conversations we've been having over the last several years about hours. In 2016, we had a real philosophical discussion about, you know, what is fair and equitable across the all 10 branches. We really came down to the concept that size, use, and amenities of branches should affect public service hours. And we had a long and frank conversation about not necessarily having the financial wherewithal to offer a 65-hour-a-week schedule across all 10 branches. At the time, we reorganized the library into three regions, and our goal was to add public service hours, but to ensure that that full spectrum of public service hours were available across regions rather than across every branch. At that point in time, we did a pilot program where we added 5 full-time equivalent staff and added 66 public service hours across the 10 branches. I can say over the first year, the pilot was very successful. Our usage went up and our customers were very, very happy about extended public service hours. I just also want to say is when we did the strategic plan in 2016, it was the single thing our patrons had asked for the most. Well, then 2017, we had this wonderful opportunity to both remodel and in some case replace our branches with the passage of Measure S and the issuance of the bonds. What that really did is create a situation where we are forced to close the branches due to these remodels or reconstructions. And our decision at that point was to take the staff from those current branches, and let's just take Capitola as a good example. It was a relatively small branch, I think 4,000 square feet, but heavily utilized. We took the staff, we assigned them to the Live Oak branch and the Aptos branch and extended hours there as a way to provide services to the public while that branch was closed. We've done that with each iteration of a remodel or reconstruction since. And that seems to be working well, but hours have been fluid as a result. Now COVID hits this spring, and we're suddenly into a really different model of providing library services. We are looking to the county health director, and now the state librarian has also been working with the state, giving guidance to libraries about where they should be, how open. But that is also heavily impacting our public services. And to be honest, I don't have a real sense of when we're going to be open and serving the public in the way we were in February. And then on top of that, we've now had huge and significant cuts in staff. So my recommendation, because of this incredibly fluid environment, is for you to allow me to set the hours. I have talked to the Library Advisory Commission, and they're more than willing to work with library administration to work with the communities to talk about how we do this. I also believe that we can come back at every meeting and talk about our plans for the next 2 months so that you can have input into it and the public could express concerns to you about changes. but I believe that the changes are going to be so extreme over the next 12 months that we will be setting new libraries hours almost monthly. The last thing that I had suggested was that the board approve a series of furloughs where the libraries would be closed for 6 weeks over the next fiscal year. It would be contingent upon successful negotiations with the unions. Based upon what I'm hearing, my recommendation is likely to pull this and bring a modified version of it back in August if there are negotiations that are successful regarding furloughs. But I don't think we'll be able to accomplish the 4th of July week closure. And just as a point of clarity, we have this complicated relationship between the JPA and the city about employment. So what I'm trying to do is ensure that both the JPA and the city agree to the approach that we take with employees. But it is the JPA's authority to open or close the libraries for a holiday or a furlough. So inevitably, if we are going to close all the libraries during the period of time, the JPA will need to approve that.
Okay. Are there any questions for Susan? Seeing none.
Actually, I have one. So, or maybe it's partially a question and a comment. So, at the city, we are obviously negotiating, and our hope is to try to have negotiations completed so that we can begin the furloughs with the beginning of the fiscal year. And if that is accomplished, then the first week in July would be doable. However, if that isn't, then that would be off the table. Susan, then you would then come back with if we're able to have a successful furlough program, but not do it within this time frame, you'd have to come back with an alternative period. Is that what you're saying?
Technically, you could approve item 3 of the public service hour strategy because it is contingent upon successful negotiations with the union.
Okay.
You could do that.
Okay.
I don't think we would notify the public we were closing until we had a bird in hand.
Okay. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? I guess the one just point of clarification I'd like to ask is that, are you suggesting that you would effectively be briefing the board about the schedule for the branches for the upcoming period before it was implemented? So in other words, we would know, you're suggesting, yeah. No. Well, help me understand that, if it would be after the fact or in the middle of a change in the hours or before?
Honestly, for public communication and simplicity's sake, I think we should pull item 3. And I think you need to approve changes to the library schedule in advance.
I'm sorry. I wasn't asking about item 3. I was asking about when you were saying that we were empowering you to schedule and, you know, work on the different schedules for the different branches. And you were suggesting that you could come and report to the board about what was happening.
Next. Yep.
Next.
So I would do it in advance.
You do it in advance. Okay. That's the answer I was actually expecting and what I was hoping for. So thank you.
And Jamie, the one sort of qualification I would say is if the public health order would change, we would follow it.
Yeah, understood. Understood. Okay, if there are no other questions, I will go to public comment. Moderator Jones, do we have any public comment this evening?
Chair Goldstein, there are no public comments on this agenda item.
Okay. I will bring it back to the board for discussion. Does anyone have any comments on this? Thoughts?
And if not, I'll jump in a little bit. I just, again, to just reference my comments earlier on the prior agenda item, just fluidity is the word of the year, and just recognizing we are in extraordinary circumstances and knowing that we have to be very nimble and make the best operational decisions upon what's in front of us. So I trust Susan and staff to come up with a good program. I like the fact that we'll know ahead of time. So I do support providing that flexibility through the entire fiscal year at this point. Again, knowing that we'll be revisiting and talking quite frequently throughout the year. So I will go ahead then and move items 1, 2, and 4, as it was recommended that we just defer an item 3 for now because of some of the complexities. I believe I heard that from the library director. So item 1 is to empower the library director to determine branch hours through fiscal year 2021. Empower the library director to schedule the opening and closure of branches for remodeling in order to maximize public service hours while the library system manages this period of limited staffing, and also request staff update this board at each meeting on projected changes to the schedule. And we also discussed that'd be in advance as well. So that's the motion I would make, and with my thanks again to staff.
I'll second that motion, and I guess we'll have to see how it works in terms of being able to provide the board with notice in advance. I think it may be very challenging at times. And so, especially given our meeting schedule. So, well, I'm all for it, but I think it may be challenging to do that. But we'll see how it works and see if you're able to do that. I just think you're going to have to be very, very flexible. We're going to have to be very flexible with combination of the all the construction going on and the pandemic. It just seems like we're going to have to be extraordinarily flexible. So we'll go with this, but I understand if you'll have to come back and you may not always be able to give us advance notice, I know, in the future.
All right. Is there any other comment? Well, I just do want to note one thing is that, you know, crises can bring people together and drive them apart. And, you know, for those of you who've had a long-term history with this board, the question of service hours and how the different jurisdictions were going to relate to each other around service hours was frankly an item that was forged in fire in the JPA agreement and required a unanimous vote by the entire board prior to any change, even a half hour in any branch library. And so it's just very encouraging to me to see how far we've come. Where I think everybody is pulling together and recognizes, I think as Director Palacio said, the challenges and the need to be limber. And I know how hard fought the language was about how set in stone those hours were gonna be. And I just appreciate everybody's willingness to adapt, and I hope the community's willingness to adapt and our staff's willingness to adapt and move quickly in these difficult times. So with that, is there any further discussion? Seeing none, I'll call for a roll call vote, please.
Director Friend?
Aye.
Director Palacios?
Yes.
Vice Chair Bernal?
Yes.
Chair Goldstein?
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Okay, so that takes us to item C on our agenda this evening, which is a City of Santa Cruz Early Retirement Incentive Program. Susan, do we have a staff report?
I'm requesting that the Powers Board approve the use of a retirement program, incentive program that is being offered by the City of Santa Cruz. This program does allow the library director to say yes or no to any particular retirement based upon business needs. We have had a number of people express an interest in doing this. I think the one difficulty I have is that I believe this program's utility might change depending upon the way in which the 10% reduction to regular staff salary costs occurs. If it's furloughs, if it's layoffs, if it's other decisions, there might be greater interest or lesser interest on behalf of management of the library in doing this. I would like you to approve the program And then we will continue to work with the city to find agreements over these issues with the employees and then make a determination of whether this can be offered in the libraries.
All right, is there any, are there any questions from the board?
Just a comment, not necessarily a question, but just to reiterate what Susan said as it relates also to the budget, that obviously this is intertwined with the ability to do a furlough program. If we are forced to consider layoffs, it would be difficult to implement a program in that context. So just wanted to highlight that.
All right. Moderator Jones, do we have any public comment on this item?
Chair Goldstein, there's no public comment on this item.
Okay, so I'll bring it back to the board for discussion. Is there any additional discussion? Is there a motion?
I'll move to approve the recommendation.
I'll second that.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Do you want to get the point that both Martine that you made and Susan you made, that this approval is contingent upon finding a solution with the groups that doesn't involve layoffs? Do you want that as part of the motion?
Sure, I think that would be yeah. Fine and consistent with the city negotiations. But yes, I would say yes.
Okay,
I'll add that to the motion.
Okay, is that okay with the seconder?
Yes.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second to approve the staff recommendation with the caveat that this is really just only if we're able to reach agreement with the groups and avoid layoffs. Further discussion? Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Director Friend?
Aye.
Director Palacios?
Yes.
Vice Chair Bernal?
Yes.
Chair Goldstein?
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. So with that, I believe that takes us to the end of tonight's agenda. Our next meeting, as I mentioned earlier, is scheduled for August 6th, 9 a.m. at the downtown branch. Hopefully we can do it in person, but obviously that will depend on what's going on with the current health orders at that time. Is there anything else, Susan, you'd like to add?
I just want to thank you all for your leadership. These are really difficult times, and you've given me great guidance, and I appreciate that.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all. Stay safe and be well. Good night.
Good night.